Hi, I'm Mike Dennison. I'm filling in for Chris today. Thanks for joining us. As you're driving down Walnut Grove Road or Germantown Parkway and you look out over the fields there, you might not know it, but you're looking at the world's largest urban farm and an important agricultural research facility. From the clothes you wear to the food you eat and the fuel in your car, your life has been touched by the work that goes on out at AgriCenter. Today, we're going to give you a tour of the AgriCenter and talk about some of the important research that's going on out there. That's just ahead on the Family Plot, Gardening in the Mid-South. So stay with us.
This is a production of WKNO Memphis. Production funding for the Family Plot, Gardening in the Mid-South is provided by Goodwin's Landscape and Garden Center in Germantown since 1943 and continuing to offer its plants for successful gardening with 7 greenhouses and 3 acres of plants, plus comprehensive landscape services. Goodwin's Landscape and Garden Center. The WKNO Production Fund. The WKNO Endowment Fund. And by viewers like you. Thank you.
Hi, welcome to the Family Plot. I'm Mike Dennison, and joining me today is Dr. Bruce Kirksey. Dr. Kirksey is the Director of Research out at the AgriCenter, and we also have with us Becky Muller. Becky is our local UT Agricultural Extension Agent. Let's talk a little bit about AgriCenter, a little bit about the history. I know that in 1979, a group of folks got together and decided that we were going to put together a facility. We needed a facility that would highlight agriculture. And initially, AgriCenter was, the mission was to showcase the newest and the brightest and the best of agriculture, and they were going to use static displays. But very quickly we learned that agriculture was changing so fast that static display, by the time you got it built and put together, it was obsolete. But these group of folks that got together were successful in securing grants from the state and county and land from the county, and today we have a facility that, in my opinion, is doing more than these guys originally planned for it to do. So, Bruce, tell us a little bit about some of the research that's going on out there. I guess start by how many acres, how large a facility do we have out there?
Yeah, well, AgriCenter definitely is a unique place. I've been doing research for like 25 years, and this facility is it's just unique in the way that they do business with different companies. But AgriCenter has about 1,000 acres total, and we have about 775 acres that we are growing crops on, and part of that land we are doing research on. So we have about 250 acres that we're conducting research trials on at the AgriCenter. And like I said, there's a lot going on that most people don't even see, especially with all the different crops and things like that.
I think we've got a soybean field on screen right now. Yeah. I know we have you have some of the most advanced technology going on out there right now. I know this past year you've got a planter that is just phenomenal, this world planner that you need in order to keep up with what you're putting in the ground and different varieties and things like that. And you also got a new irrigation system this year that's, I know, GPS guided.
Right. And you gotta look at producing crops is gotten high tech, and a lot of the farms are getting bigger and bigger. And one of the things that we do at AgriCenter is that we try to conduct research so that a farmer or a producer can use that data and end up taking that to his farm. So, yeah, we've got Precision Ag out there. We've got an RTK base station that we have set up, and we are using our tractors. Our tractors are equipped with a GPS, and they're auto-steered. So it's not like, we just leave it alone, but
not like the GPS in our cars. It's a little bit more advanced than
that. You need to hang on to the wheel. But the good thing about the GPS is that we can plant a straighter row. And the straighter the row is, the higher yield. I mean, that we've proven that with research trials. And you mentioned the irrigation system. As you know, this year we've had a pretty droughty year.
It's been dry.
It's been hot. We went from winter to summer in just overnight.
No spring.
No spring at all. And we've been irrigating certain crops and on our experiments, and it's actually saved it.
Yeah.
So the irrigation system that we've got is guided by GPS also. So, you know, it travels in a straight line. So we're able to go in there and put in an experiment underneath that and precisely put out water as it's moving through the field.
Yeah. It's just amazing what you can do with the GPS technology. I mean, you could even theoretically on that irrigation system put out different amounts of water depending upon the soil texture,
mm-hmm.
you know, from one end of the field to the other.
Oh, yeah.
And it's just very amazing. Yeah. Well, what kind of, on the plots that you see out there, you're driving down the road and you see these signs up out there, what are they looking at? Is it, you know, pesticides or is mm-hmm. it varieties or what?
Yeah.
Talk a little bit about that.
Well, at the Agri Center, we do a lot of different kinds of experiments. So we're currently working with about 30 companies. So we have a contract with these companies to conduct research trials. So and there a lot of them are chemical companies or seed companies or plant health products. So another unique thing about the Agri Center is that these companies can bring in their sales force or their or bring in growers, and they can see firsthand what those products look like. But we've got a lot of variety trials out this year. And when you're driving down the road and you see these signs up, it's probably a sign that's telling what has been sprayed in that field or what variety that was planted in that field.
Yeah. You know, one thing that's kind of interesting about these crop protection materials, you know, you can look at it as kind of like it's medicine for plants, and probably as much research goes into the medicines that we apply to plants as the medicines we as humans take,
mm-hmm.
and they have an added thing that they also have to look at the environmental impact.
Right.
So you know, medicines for people, they don't often do environmental
right.
impact studies on.
Well, a lot of the products that we get they're experimental products, and once we conduct the research trials on that, we destroy those. Once we get the yield data, we destroy those. But by the time that we get them to do research on, the companies have already had them for 10 or 12 years.
Right, they've been looking at them for a long
and
time.
And then a lot of the products that we have, they won't be registered or available to a grower for another 2 or 3 years.
Yeah.
So there's an awful lot of work going in, registration and data collecting on these products.
Yeah. How many different crops have you got growing out at Agri Center? What have you got out there?
Oh, we've got a lot of crops. I don't know if I can give you a number, but we do a lot of with our basic agronomic crops, corn, cotton, soybeans, wheat. In the past few years, we've had more interest in biofuel type crops or crops that we're interested in seeing if they can grow in the Mid-South. So we're doing work with sunflowers and miscanthus and switchgrass. And different types of brassicas, and we're basically studying those to see how well we can grow those in the Mid-South.
And from what I've seen, we can grow them.
Oh yeah, we can definitely
grow them. All of them. I haven't seen any of those we've had any problems growing.
Right.
Beautiful switchgrass field out there, and beautiful sunflowers. I know people driving up and down Walnut Grove or Germantown Road can enjoy the sunflowers.
Oh yeah. Well, the sunflowers I think would have a very good fit because you know, in the Mid-South we grow quite a bit of wheat. And we can, after we harvest wheat, part of a rotation plan, instead of planting beans, we could plant sunflowers.
Yeah.
You know, so it gives the grower another option.
Yeah, that's pretty neat. We have some other crops out there. I know we've got bamboo.
Mm-hmm.
We're feeding the pandas from Agri Center. A lot of folks don't realize that. And I know I've seen personally some rice.
Mm-hmm.
We've got probably the biggest rice producer in West Tennessee, just
yeah,
about.
Maybe pretty know. Close. Yeah,
and we've got two or three little rice fields out there, rice paddies. I saw some peanut research going on out
right.
there this
mm-hmm.
year. But and then you also have a forestry planting. You've got a planted pine plantation
right.
out there.
That's right. There's a wide variety, and that's some of the things that we want to be able to provide to a company is be able to do research for them. So we have plans to put in a turf area where we can look at different types of turf, you know, whether it's the golf course market or the homeowner market, just looking at how those can grow in our area.
I want you to get some of that shade-tolerant Bermuda grass that the
okay,
that's
that would
that's
be
coming
a,
out of Georgia.
We need,
some, we need some
product.
Of that.
Yep, absolutely. We also have plans to put in orchards. I'm kind of looking at putting in just a few apples and peach plantings, and that way we have that available to growers or to researchers if they want to come in and do some
kind of
research. Yeah.
And that reminds me of strawberries and pumpkins. We have both of those.
That's right,
out there.
Yeah.
And, right, and we're growing a pretty good corn maize out there right now, too, aren't
That's
we?
Right, yeah. I'm not sure what the, it'll be a big surprise what the design is this year, but it's off to a very good start.
Yeah. Well, what I know AgriCenter offers several levels of management with these companies.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, some of the companies do their own thing out there, kind of
right.
just rent the land from you. And,
right.
And then.
Well, that's, again, another unique thing about the AgriCenter. It's a little bit different than other, like the universities or the other contract trials, research areas. But like I said earlier, we've got 30 companies that we're doing research for, and we basically set up a contract with them. If they have their own equipment and manpower, then they can just rent land from AgriCenter and they can conduct their own trials. But, you know, we have to have an agreement in place, you know, make sure that what they're doing, that both parties understand what's going to happen. And then a lot of the, or most of the trials that we do, we take care of everything. So we prepare the ground, we plant, we spray, if that's what the protocol calls for. We evaluate it, harvest it, summarize the data, and we even go and present that if that's what they want us to do. So we have the capabilities to do all kind of different trials like that, and makes it very unique. And the other thing that's is interesting is that we're also a location for the University of Tennessee.
Right.
So they do a variety testing program, and we do corn and soybeans and wheat there. And it goes into their overall summary to give growers an idea of what the best products are for their area.
Yeah, I know, Becky, you've got a Asian soybean rust sentinel plot out
I
there
do.
That you get to go out and play with every week, don't you?
Mm-hmm. Bruce planted me a fungicide-free little area, and I go out every Monday and take kind of a growth rating, find out what vegetative and reproductive stage that the soybean's in, and then I pick 100 leaf samples that get FedExed to a lab in Jackson, Tennessee, where they check every week to see if we've gotten any Asian soybean rust, which it does come our way, but thank goodness it doesn't come until well after October when most of the beans are out of the field anyway.
You know, in the research and technology that's going on out there, you know, how do we get that out to the farmer? How does the end user, mm-hmm. you know, end up with that?
Right. Well, there's several ways, and you got to remember that a lot of the things that we're conducting now, the experiments that we're conducting now, it's confidential. So that information goes to the companies, and then in 2 or 3 years, the companies will present that information to the growers, because the trials and things that we're doing there go into a package that they present to the EPA and the FDA
right.
to get a product registered. We also have a field day every other year, and we had one this year on July 21st, the hottest day of the year.
Yeah.
And yeah, we had a pretty good...
Pictures were made, I think.
Yeah, we had a pretty good turnout, and very pleased with everything, how everything looked. But that gives a grower an opportunity to come to AgriCenter, and we had 20-something stops set up, and each stop was a company. So a grower can get on a tour wagon, go to and see what the different companies have to offer. One of the other things that we're is in the works is we're going to be putting together on our website summaries, research summaries of some trials that we've done. It'd be more pictures and graphs and tables and things like that that the farmer can get online and look and see what they can do on their farm.
Yeah. And, you know, it's really making an impact out there. It impacts the homeowner, the price they pay for groceries. And for some examples of yields, what have yields done in the past? What research and all the technology has increased yields in the past 10 years? I know when I moved to Shelby County back in 1995, our average cotton yield was 600 pounds per acre. And Becky, what do you think they're looking at now?
Sometimes even on a year where we've struggled, it's been 800 to 950 pounds.
Right. Corn yields, 80 bushels, 80, 90, a good year, 100 bushels per acre back in the early 90s. What do you think they are right now?
We've had a couple of rough years out on some of my plots. Mm-hmm.
150 is not unusual. 160 is dry land. Irrigated corn can be approaching 200 bushels.
Yeah, absolutely.
To the point where the American farmer today feeds 155 people. When I started in this line of work back 30 years ago, he was feeding about 80, I think. So it allows folks like us to do what we do instead of having a real big garden and trying to grow everything that we eat. So it's quite impressive. I know I've done a little work out there this year. I've done more work there this year than I have in a long time. And I know on the plots that I've worked with, we've done herbicides, looking at weed control. And right now, the problem we've got out there is we have some weeds that are resistant to some of the herbicides that we've been using for the past few years. And I know there's a tremendous amount of work done on that, fungicides and insecticides. We have insects and weeds have a knack for developing resistance to the materials that we use. And so there's always going to be the need for this kind of, you know, research and technology.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And, you know, when you look at what we're doing there at AgriCenter, it's real world.
Right, it is.
It's the same kind of things that the producers, the growers in West Tennessee and North Mississippi and Arkansas are facing. We're just looking at it on a smaller scale.
Yeah. The same thing they face every day. I saw something, farmers, to have a real good crop, a lot of things have to go right.
Mm-hmm.
A whole lot of things have to go right. And one thing can go wrong and totally wipe them out.
Yeah.
So it's pretty frustrating. A lot of other things going on out at AgriCenter. Research is one of the main missions of AgriCenter. It's probably the main mission of AgriCenter. Most of the public goes to shows out at the Expo Center, and that is also a mission, recreation, and those kind of things. You know, I sit on the AgriCenter board, and when what I like to say is we do all those things so we can afford to do the research down there on the farm. Also, education is a very, very important component of AgriCenter's mission, we have people that, a couple of folks that do educational activities out there, environmental science educational activities as well as the agricultural science education activities. There's an outdoor classroom out there in that planted pine plantation. You know, backs right up there to the Lucius Birch Natural Area, and it's just a tremendous amount of things going on out there.
And don't you think that's one of the most important things when you have youth that's growing up in the city to get out there and see where their clothes come from and things?
That's right. Remember, we'd like to hear from you. Here's how to send an email or a letter and maybe a photo or two for future shows.
Send us an email with your questions and a photo or two. The address is familyplot@wkno.org. Or if you'd rather send a letter, the mailing address is WKNO Attention Family Plot, 7151 Cherry Farms Road, Cordova, Tennessee. The zip is 38016. We're looking forward to hearing from you.
Okay, first email question that we've got, and this is Becky, our local county agent. Last year I had a bumper crop, way more than usual, of healthy ripe acorns on my 20-year-old sawtooth oak. This year all of the acorns are falling prematurely in July, and they're only about the size of my small fingernail. We had a drought last summer, we remember that, and we also are having some dry weather this summer. So the weather has been relatively the same. What do you think's going on with that sawtooth oak?
Well, I think they kind of hit it right on the head about some of the stress from the drought, but sawtooth oaks are known to produce acorns a lot earlier than other varieties of oak trees. And when you think about stressing them with drought and heat, they have to kind of shut off some of the production to the acorns to just survive. So, you know, I don't know if he can try to get that acorn tree a little bit more moisture, you know, in the soil and everything, or just expect that when we have these really dry, hot summers, that they're not going to have the acorn production. They just kind of abort it just to survive.
Yeah, you know, I know working with pecans over the years, and probably the same thing is true of a lot of nut trees. They tend to store up energy in the fall for next year's crop. And if the conditions aren't good in late summer and early fall for them to store up energy, then it will really adversely affect the crop next year.
Right.
And that very well could be the problem. Next question. Peaches on my tree are not growing well. What could be the problem?
I think we're going to run into some of the same answers on a lot of this. Oh. And there are several things. I know a lot of homeowners who get into growing fruit trees don't realize sometimes that they really need to be on a spray program. And really and truly, probably a soil test would help. I know we've kind of hammered in the soil test on this show over and over.
Yeah, it needs a high pH. It needs 6.5 at least on peach tree.
Yeah, need to figure out where you stand with your fertility with the tree. And then you have to understand, we had a weird spring. We kind of bounced back and forth. And sometimes you have to have a certain amount of cold weather for the peach tree to put on blossoms. But then once it blossoms out, if you have weather that snaps back and forth, your blossoms could have been frozen, and then that's going to stunt some of your, you know, fruit growth later.
Yeah.
So there's several different things that could go on, you know, but my thought is probably it had a lot to do with our weather.
Yeah. We're assuming that the homeowner has got a regular spray program with this peach tree. You can't successfully grow peaches, plums, or nectarines in this area unless you know, religiously use cover sprays.
The fungicides, you know, and the
insecticides. Fungicides and insecticides every 7 to 10 days during the growing season and while the fruit's on the tree.
Right.
And if you're not doing that, then you have either the plum curculio or brown rot on
mm-hmm.
the peaches. And we're assuming that you're following the spray schedule on that. When do you plant leafy vegetables for fall production?
I had to do a little looking up at this because it's been a while since I've worked on it. But the planting dates for lettuce is around July 1st to September 15th. Spinaches are September 10th to September 20th. Turnips are going to be August 1st to September 30th. Then kale is going to be July 1st to September 1st. And your collards are going to be from July to September 1st. So
basically now.
Now. You need to get on it.
Now you need to get them out there. And maybe if you put them out there, we'll get a little shower and they'll come on up and do well. I have probably time for maybe one or two more. I have green worms that are eating my tomatoes. How do I control them? Probably the tomato fruit worm.
Yeah. And, you know, there are several things you have to consider when you're going to be putting out any kind of insecticides with tomatoes. You need to make sure that you read the label, because there's going to be a certain amount of time from when you put that insecticide out to when you can harvest and eat the tomato. But things like 7, or there was another product.
BT, Bacillus thuringiensis, works well on
that. That'll work well on that. And sometimes it helps to have a little bit more information than just a green worm, because there are a lot of different things. A lot of different insects that could be munching on them right now.
How often do I need to water my lawn this time of the year?
Well, what you need to consider, it's not necessarily how often. It's that they need to have about 1 to 1.5 inches per week. And you want to make sure that you're getting moisture down into the soil about 4 to 6 inches. Because the deeper that you can get it, the better off the root system in your lawn is going to be. If you do a lot of short and infrequent watering, you're teaching your the grass to have very shallow roots, and it doesn't survive as long. So one of the things that you need to consider is you need to let it show drought stress. So when you step through your lawn and you can see your footprint, you need to water it, but you need to leave it on where you're getting a good 1.5 inches a week.
Mm-hmm. Well, folks, I'm afraid that's all we have time for today. Be sure to join us next week, and remember, you can send us an email or a letter with your gardening questions and photos. I'm Mike Dennison, and we hope to see you next time on The Family Plot, Gardening in the Mid-South.
Production funding for The Family Plot, Gardening in the Mid-South is provided by Goodwin's Landscape and Garden Center in Germantown since 1943 and continuing to offer its plants for successful gardening with 7 greenhouses and 3 acres of plants, plus comprehensive landscape services. Goodwin's Landscape and Garden Center.